Thank you for coming out, and look forward to hearing your questions and learning together.
I just want to say thank you to Barney's for just organizing this, as well as my name, Schomburg. Thank you to the audience. I have to keep it real to the audience from the beginning. I'm tired, y'all. And I actually mean that figuratively. I'm here for the past 24 hours. It's been a rough week for the movement. You know, anytime you wake up on Tuesday to videos of black men being executed in Baton Rouge, and then you wake up on Wednesday to videos of black people being executed in Minneapolis, and then you wake up on Thursday night and Friday morning to videos of police officers being shot in Dallas, you know that we are in the middle of a third reconstruction. And so I want to start there in terms of how we can, I want to talk about two things briefly. First, how we can think about Black Lives Matter historically, and then how we can think about Black Lives Matter in relationship to Afro-Latino. With regards to the first point, the first thing to say about Black Lives Matter is that Black Lives Matter is an abolitionist movement, right? And abolitionist movements always have particular kinds of backlash. We know that one of the ways that white supremacy tends to operationalize itself historically is that abolitionist movements are almost always met with virulent anti-white backlash. So this began in the context of the abolitionist movement of the 19th century, right? Where you had the emancipation of African slaves, which was the success of the abolitionist movement. But then it was met by what? It was immediately met by post-Reconstruction, after Reconstruction, post-Reconstruction, which resulted in the lynching and terror of African-American communities for the next 45 years. Fast forward to the middle of the 20th century, you had the Civil Rights Movement, which in some ways was also an abolitionist movement, in the sense that it was an attempt to abolish the laws that excluded African-Americans from full participation into the civic institutions of the nation. And that movement had success in that regard. But then it was immediately met with the virulent anti-white backlash that took the form of the realignment of the Republican Party, the realignment of the Democrats Party, the rise of Nixonism, Reaganism. We could go on and on. And so what am I getting at? We are in the middle of a third reconstruction. And it makes sense that over the course of the past 8 years in the Obama administration, we have seen both the rise of the Tea Party on the conservative right at the beginning of his presidency to now the rise of Donald Trump, which is happening in response to the imagined progress of having a black man in office. Now, many of us in the movement don't really think that the Obama presidency has been necessarily a progressive presidency by any means. But in the white racist imagination, any black body in the White House is progress, and so that progress has to be met with backlash. And so the movement is experiencing that backlash in this moment. We need to think about that as Black Lives Matter emerging in the context of being an abolitionist movement that is dealing with this cycle of backlash. Also, Black Lives Matter is also a human rights movement, right? Which is different than it being a civil rights movement. Traditionally, the black freedom struggle in the United States has often been a civil rights movement, which is about asking for certain rights. But it's already illegal for a police officer to unlawfully shoot a person. But it's still happening, right? So that Black Lives Matter is not simply asking for a new right. We are asking for a human right, right? So this is a human rights movement, which means that the ask of the movement is different. And so when people say things like, well, you know, there hasn't been legislative success. Well, listen, this is not a civil rights movement. We're talking about a human rights movement. Human rights means that we need to recognize that we live in a nation and in a world where the very idea that black people are human beings is a relatively recent development in the history of the West. This is a fact. So those are the kind of historical contexts. Now, with regards to this question of Black Lives Matter in Latin America, I have to admit that there's a danger in having that conversation, right? Because when we talk about Black Lives Matter in Latin America, we need to be careful not to end up, we can see how that conversation can quickly become yet another form of US cultural imperialism, right? This idea, which is what Black Lives Matter has always been against. So we need to resist this urge about thinking about Black Lives Matter as somehow this US cultural export that is now being exported abroad to brown communities around the globe, civilizing them and politicizing them. The fact of the matter is, long before Black Lives Matter emerged in 2013, there has always been a movement for black lives. That began when the first slaves were engaging in insurrectory behavior in the context of the transatlantic slave trade, right? So long before there was a Black Lives Matter movement, there was a movement for Black lives alive both in Latin America as well as in the United States. But also, we need, so before we talk about Black Lives Matter in Latin America, we would do well to think about how Latin America and Latinos have always already been present in the story of the U.S. Black Lives Matter, right? So we know, many of you already know the story of the three black women who were responsible for the hashtag Black Lives Matter, right? Every time I speak their name, I want to honor them for that labor. Opal Tometi, Patrice Cullors, and then who was the third person? Alicia Garza. And so I want to focus a second on the story of Alicia Garza, because I think it complicates the ways in which we talk about African-American identity. And part of what the work of Afro-Latino politics has been about is expanding the borders of who gets to claim Latinidad. We also need to expand the borders of what constitutes an African-American. We talk about African-Americans as if they are a static group, but in fact, it's much more layered. And so Alicia's last name, Garza, comes from her husband, who is of Afro-Mexican descent. And so I would argue that Alicia is already a part, sort of literally and figuratively married into Latinidad. And that she, and when she articulated Black Lives Matter, it was always already informed by a sensibility that was in alignment with other groups. Last point is that it's important to realize that Black Lives Matter was first articulated in 2013. Not in the context of a white police officer killing an African-American male, so not in the context of Ferguson, but in the context of the Trayvon Martin case. Why is that significant? Well, what that means is that the original story, the context in which provided the condition of possibility for Black Lives Matter's emergence, was a conversation about what? A white Latino harboring anti-black racism against somebody who he should have seen as his brother. What I'm just trying to say in closing is that when we have this conversation about Black Lives Matter in Latin America and in Latinidad, we need to be careful to understand that Latinidad and Latinos have always been integral to the story of the emergence of Black Lives Matter in the U.S.
But I'm not going to take up too much time because I know everyone in here has to be dancing in their seat to speak the truth and the discomfort that we are all feeling today. So although we can't pour, I feel it necessary to pretend that we're doing a libation, to call out the name of the ancestors that we are standing on, and those who we are calling out, Alton Sterling and Philando. We need to call their names out and bring it into this space for us to really understand why this conversation is absolutely crucial to them. So, bouncing off of you, but I'm going another way. The Latino term still carries a European context in this country. It's not a term I necessarily jump up and down for. I'm Panamanian. I'm Colonesa. If you're Panamanian and you're Colonesa, you already know you black. And you already know that your life may not matter in the context of Colombia. So Black Lives Matter in a hashtag is one thing. The reality is a whole nother ballgame. To be black in Latin America has always been up for discussion. To be Colonesa in Panama, you already know that you're not visible, that you are excluded, that you are not heard. To be a woman, yes. Black, and Latina, yes. Who wants to extend? Answer. What comes with that? What comes with that? So, we already know that Black Lives Matter. The Red de Mujeres Afro, we are 100 plus 50 women, 200 women from every Latin American country. And when you see us together, que sea de Argentina, que sea de Panama, que sea de Costa Rica, que sea de Brasil, que sea de Honduras, the story is still the same. We get harassed walking in the street. Yes. We're over-sexualized wherever we go, and some of us end up dead. What we don't realize is we always feel like Latinos have to look, or Panamanians have to look into the U.S. to have a context. Black power movement was also happening in Latin American and the Caribbean. And a lot of the black power folks in this country are of Caribbean and Latin American descent. So we were already doing this. We just have a hashtag that says, you know, we gotta go on Twitter, we gotta put it. But this was already our story. Black, gun, and blood has become the norm. For all of us. I don't think anybody in here is safe. I am Sandra Bland. Because I would have been like, why are you stopping me? Why are you asking me these questions? And why am I still here? Because that's who I am. So I am Sandra Bland. Michael Brown could have been Panamanian, if you know the Panamanian context. We need to call Latinos out. This is not an Afro-Latino conversation alone. We already know we black. We already know we don't matter. And even in the context of what it means to be Latino, the conversation we're having is us speaking to the choir. We're the non-identified Latinos who need to honor who we are in that bigger space. We're asking for Black Lives Matter, but Black Lives doesn't even matter in the Latino context, as Latinos are defined in this country. John Vick and I don't even get credit for being Panamanian, and we're born and raised. We don't have green. Somos los víctimas. Nacidas y criadas. And we still have to explain to the Latinos que no hablan español, pero nosotras sí. Pero yo tengo un afro y tú tienes tu dress, so that kills me. So Black Lives Matter is not a new conversation for those who are black, wherever we are standing. The difference now is the numbers, the videos are showing that the deaths are happening. He said a prophet, 2012, Colón, Panama, my cousin, raped and killed and left in between two pipes. Rape was not done porque era fiestas patrias. It was a long weekend, so no one did anything. I'm here in Boston going, Daddy, you need to go and make sure they do a race kit. No, no lo hicieron porque. No fue solo porque fue fiestas patrias. This was a black woman that they didn't take into account. When the folks called, they didn't call the police. First, they called the media. And the next day, the front page of the paper was Gisela's body in between the pipes. So please do not tell me this is a new conversation. This is old. It's just gotten worse visibly. Because it's been happening. It's just now we have names and we get reported and someone catches it on video. But we, you know, recently a woman said, but we're visible, I see you. When was the last time you invited one of us to your table? When was the last time you really wanted to hear the truth and sit in your discomfort? If you're not uncomfortable now, even with me speaking to you, then that's an issue you need to deal with. Because this is an uncomfortable conversation. This is about colorism within us. This is about classism within us, because it all plays itself out on how we even call ourselves to matter to each other. The healing is not only going to happen with how they see us. The healing has to happen how we see ourselves. Because how many of you really, I'm just walking around here, I had no people speaking to me in English. This is the Afro-Latino Festival. Try it. Talk to me in Spanish. I'll respond back. But we don't even give ourselves that. So we can't be asking for anyone to get, you know, black power, black centralized, eccentric movement is about taking care of ourselves first. And that blackness piece is key. The Latino piece is a culture. We were dropped off everywhere. We speak an imposed language. We dress in imposed clothing. We do all of the stuff that it goes, and we celebrate it more than when it needs to be. Natural in your hair, eccentric in your dressing, and just black love all the time. So let us get it together. It's not just about outside, it's about inside too. So the conversation is, how do we as Latinos even matter to each other when our blackness is at the forefront of that conversation? I'm done.
Thank you, Beth. First, I want to say thank you. I've been here since this morning, and it's been really, really, really powerful to be in this space. I'm realizing I just trusted the universe, my spirit, to come here. Last night, I was debating if I would just come just for the panel. I just didn't have the energy to really be out in the world, and I'm glad that I did, because being in these spaces, it's sort of what Beth was saying of like, there's a difference between understanding who you are to be in the world and being in a community that reflects that regularly. And that this is a space that has done that for me today in affirming in beautiful ways. And it's just mind blowing when you're in a space of black people that speak Spanish to you that are saying like, we embrace this, because that's not necessarily the world that I grew up in, the space that I grew up in. So it's really, really, really powerful to be here. I had notes and things. I don't really want to talk about the notes. I just want to say that a few things. One is, part of the reason I'm here is because a few months, or maybe 7 months ago, a little bit after Thanksgiving, I was in my bed. My room is, I cleaned my room in a way that it brings light, and I love windows and sunlight and all those things. And I woke up that morning feeling really heavy. My room felt really dark. I was depressed. And I was trying to figure out, how do I work through this moment of feeling super heavy, acknowledging that I had experienced some really tough things personally last year, and also being a part of this activist work, being black enough in the world, being black in the world, the weight of that, what does that actually mean? And when you're consciously trying to fight that regularly, you have to be real about how often we're people to give and give and give, and we're broken, and we don't really get spaces to heal. And so I was sitting there thinking about, how do I create a way to heal myself? And listening to my spirit, and it's saying that I needed to, this part of my healing journey had to be in community. And so I thought about a picture I had taken of my mom a few weeks before at this art showing. And she was really happy, she was smiling. I remember her saying, I love this painting. And so I posted that on Facebook with a simple statement that talked about the experience of joy as a form of resistance, and that we needed to be able